We live in a changing world in which emergency response personnel must be prepared to deal with an ever-increasing variety of incidents. Responding to hazardous material accidents is a special challenge for emergency response personnel. Safety of both the public and response personnel depends on planning, training, and practice. Radioactive material is one class of hazardous material, and response to an accident involving radioactive material is similar to other hazardous material accidents. Radioactive material can be found in small amounts in smoke detectors, in homes, institutions, and offices. Although the use of radioactive material has increased in recent years, accidents involving these materials are rare. Radiation accidents can occur in industrial plants, university laboratories, construction sites, nuclear power plants, hospitals, and during the transportation of radioactive materials. For the most part, radioactive material is safely used and transported by a wide variety of vehicles throughout our towns, cities, and rural areas every day, equaling approximately 3 million shipments a year. As a responder, you encounter many kinds of emergencies entailing varying degrees of risk. All emergency situations are potentially dangerous, and some may be complicated by the presence of hazardous material. When you suspect that radioactive material may be present at an accident scene, take appropriate actions in accordance with your level of training and local procedures to protect people and the environment. The Emergency Response Guidebook, or ERG, states that medical problems should take priority over radiological concerns at a radioactive material incident. While the hazards associated with radioactive material should be respected, knowledge of simple protective actions will allow you to safely administer emergency medical care and perform victim rescue. The basic protection principles of time, distance, and shielding are useful in minimizing radiation exposure. Your goal is to stabilize and rescue the accident victim using these protective actions to reduce radiation exposure levels and to prevent the spread of radioactive materials on the victim, yourself, and in the environment. This video will demonstrate basic response techniques to a transportation accident involving radioactive material. Starting with the initial 911 call, the video will show responders' arrival, size up, initial response actions, scene entry, victim rescue and treatment, decontamination techniques, and transport to medical facilities.
Engines 1, Medic 1 and 2, and Hazmat Unit 1. Respond to Gateway Drive between mile marker 2 and 3 near Highway 278.
The techniques demonstrated in this video are generic in nature and are in no way intended to replace your local response procedures.
Further information will be provided by arriving units. Timeout is 0830 hours.
Arriving emergency responders position their vehicles a safe distance upwind of the accident area. The initial scene assessment takes place at this point in the response process. A useful acronym to remember throughout the response is SIN. SIN stands for Safety, Isolation, and Notification. Safety of response personnel is always the first operational thought. Responders approach the incident scene from upwind and upslope, using binoculars to identify the hazard from as far away as possible. A visual survey of the accident scene is made to determine if hazards such as fire, leaks, spills, or other hazardous cargo exist. In this case, radiological material has been identified from the markings and labels on the packages at the scene. Once all hazards have been identified, use the ERG to determine initial response actions and isolation distances.
Need everyone to step back away from
bystanders in the immediate hazard area are moved to a safe area and asked to remain there until they can be surveyed for contamination. The incident commander will determine tactical priorities. In many cases, multiple activities may occur at the same time. Firefighters wear structural firefighters protective clothing, and EMS personnel wear their standard universal precautions protective clothing. As with all hazardous material incidents, respiratory protection should be worn inside the hot zone until it is determined there is no respiratory hazard. Responders should take only necessary equipment into the hot zone to minimize contamination of equipment. Accident victims are treated based on their injuries. Remember that medical treatment takes priority over radiological concern. Use your best judgment, but do not delay life-saving care.
Oh, can you hear me?
To properly prepare the victim for removal from the hot zone, a backboard wrapped in two blankets is brought to the victim. The outer blanket is spread out on the ground, while the inner blanket is used to wrap the patient once placed on the backboard. As with any accident, the airway, breathing, and circulation of the victim are immediately assessed. Non-ambulatory victims are provided life-saving care and are prepared for removal from the hot zone. Precautions are taken for possible neck and back injuries. Radiation exposure will not cause immediate visible signs of injury.
You have to cut the clothes off, okay?
Therefore, any symptoms observed are from something other than radiation. The presence of radiation or contamination will not affect the operation of equipment. If victims are ambulatory, they are assisted out of the hazard area, and decontamination decisions are based on the nature of their injuries. Control boundaries are established based on guidance from the ERG. While EMS personnel perform rescue activities, fire personnel extinguish fires and work to recover the shipping papers.
Fire attack team, can you report on the status of the vehicle fire and have you located the shipping papers?
Fire's out. Have shipping papers in hand.
Temporal report to the decontamination corridor.
As a precaution, shipping papers are placed in plastic bags for contamination control. The shipping papers remain at the command post so that the radiation authority and emergency response personnel can have ready access to the valuable information contained on the shipping papers. Information found on shipping papers include emergency contact telephone numbers, shipper and receiver names and addresses, total number of packages, the identity of each material, the physical and chemical form of each material radionuclide, such as thallium-201, technetium-99, and iodine-123. Types of activity contained in each package. The category label applied to each package, such as radioactive yellow 2, and the transport index for each package, such as yellow 2 and yellow 3 labels only. Normally, two control lines, both extending 360 degrees, are set up at an accident site. An inner control line marking the boundary between the hot zone and the warm zone, and an outer control line separating the warm zone from the cold zone. The decontamination corridor is contained within the warm zone. At the outer control line boundary, a step-off area to the cold zone is established. Both personnel and equipment are surveyed prior to being released from the warm zone. The hot zone, also known as the exclusion zone, should only be large enough to conduct response operations and control the spread of contamination. Radiation readings at the hot zone boundary should not exceed 2 millirem per hour. The outer control line is established where radiation readings are at natural background levels. The incident command post is established in the cold zone, a safe distance away, upwind and upslope from the hazard area. All response operations are coordinated through the incident commander. Large, complex events where multiple agencies respond may require a unified command structure. The initial focus of the command post will be taking those actions needed to protect the public and response personnel. As with any hazardous material event, the incident commander has assigned positions within the incident command structure based upon the nature of the event and the availability of personnel. The incident commander monitors the situation and uses updates from the entry teams to continuously reevaluate the accident scene. Law enforcement personnel provide a critical response role.
Ma'am, sir, please get back in your vehicle. There's been a vehicle accident with serious injuries. We're working hard to clear the scene.
Typical duties at a hazardous material scene usually include protecting the public by keeping them away from the hazardous area, protection of response personnel by establishing and maintaining physical security at the incident scene, providing expert advice to other response personnel on evidence preservation, and performing accident investigation. As soon as response personnel determine that there are potentially contaminated accident victims, the command post notifies the hospital that a contaminated victim is to be transported and identifies the radioactive materials stated on the shipping papers.
Patient number one is a 31-year-old male, non-ambulatory.
What's your estimated
the hospital will need time to prepare their staff and facility. The identity of the radioactive material can aid in medical decontamination decisions.
Do you know what that is?
Life-threatening injuries have priority over radiological assessment. Clothing is removed so injuries can be fully assessed and to remove as much contamination as possible. When the victim is ready to be moved, and if time permits, field decontamination of the victim is limited to the removal of their outer clothing. This is referred to as gross decontamination. Once the victim is placed on the backboard, the inner blanket is used to wrap the patient and the outer blanket is left on the ground. This is referred to as the double blanket method and is used to minimize the spread of radiological contamination.
On the count of three. One, two, three.
The victim is then moved to the control line. Time permitting, the ambulance interior can be protected from radiological contamination by taking a few simple steps. Stow equipment and items not needed. Close all compartment doors. Establish ready access to needed treatment equipment. Wrap equipment in plastic and set up bags for disposal of contaminated items. The victim is brought to the control line where an ambulance stretcher has been prepared for packaging the victim. The victim is wrapped in another blanket to minimize the spread of contamination. Ambulance personnel should wear standard universal precautions protective clothing and face masks. If available, the victim is transported by an ambulance crew that has not been in the controlled area. En route to the hospital, additional information is relayed regarding the number of patients, their condition and medical status, and estimated time of arrival.
Involved in a high-speed motor vehicle accident. Patients possibly contaminated with radioactive material.
If known, the extent of contamination and any suspicion of internal contamination may be relayed. The ambulance crew should also ask if there is a designated entrance to the hospital's emergency department for contaminated personnel. Care should be taken to minimize the spread of contamination. This can be done by changing gloves frequently, using portable kits, bagging discarded gloves and clothing, and not opening unnecessary compartments. Once all emergency actions have been completed, responders who were in the hot zone follow a set protocol. Bunker gear, respiratory protection, and any equipment used is removed and left inside the hot zone. Specially trained personnel assist in response to an accident involving radioactive material. In this case, the local hazardous material response team arrives at the scene and begins assisting responders in surveying and releasing personnel from the controlled area.
Hey, Chris, how's it going this evening?
Fine, Chief. Good to see you. Appreciate you coming out. What we've got is a two-vehicle accident with radioactive material spilled. Two victims involved, potentially.
These personnel have knowledge, skills, and equipment that can be used to characterize and control the hazards posed by the radioactive material. In addition, this team has training in the various methods for decontamination if needed. Because radiological contamination is suspected, responders are surveyed by trained personnel. If trained personnel are not available, responders should consult with their jurisdictional radiation authority for further instructions. The radiation authority should always be consulted in any accident involving radioactive material. The radiation authority may have additional resources for assisting in the response effort. Decontamination of rescuers is directed by trained personnel. The team documents the extent and location of contamination. In this case, since radioactive material is the only hazard, only localized decontamination would be performed if contamination were detected. If multiple hazardous materials were present, the traditional decontamination method using an appropriate wash solution would be recommended. Once protective clothing has been removed and responders have been surveyed, they move to a designated location for post-incident assessment and evaluation. Upon arrival at the hospital, the ambulance is met outside the emergency entrance by hospital staff. patients will again be evaluated at this point and admitted for emergency care. The usual medical report is given, as well as information regarding the radiological status, if known. Unless needed back at the accident site, the ambulance crew bags contaminated items, secures the ambulance stretcher and transport vehicle, removes their gloves, and do not leave the controlled area. To prevent the possibility of internal contamination, they should not eat, drink, smoke, or chew. After being surveyed, and as a matter of precaution, a shower and change of clothing is recommended for ambulance personnel. The ambulance crew and their equipment return to regular service only after they have been surveyed and decontaminated if necessary. Responding to hazardous material accidents is a special challenge requiring planning, training, and practice. The safety of both the public and response personnel may depend on your knowledge and actions. Remember these points. The procedures involved in emergency rescue and transport of accident victims are very similar to those used for fire rescue or where hazardous materials are involved. Set up control lines and establish a command post upwind and upslope of the accident area. Perform rescue and life-saving treatment as soon as possible. Spend as little time as possible in the hazardous area. Stay as far as practical from heat, flames, toxic chemicals, or radioactive materials. Necessary emergency medical treatment should not be delayed by attempts to measure levels of radioactivity. Wear the appropriate level of protective clothing. Use time, distance, and shielding techniques. Do not eat, drink, smoke, or chew anything while on scene. Simple isolation precautions and contamination control techniques can prevent the spread of radioactive material. At the hospital, the usual medical report of victims is given, as well as information regarding the radiological status, if known. By employing these procedures, emergency response personnel can adequately care for the needs of accident victims while affording maximum protection to themselves and victims alike.
Thank you.